praise is the antidote to pride. The more we praise the Lord, the more thankful we are for all that he's done, and the less prideful we are. Two promises from the Lord, one from the 46th chapter of Isaiah, and the other from the 5th chapter of Luke. Hear the word of the Lord. Listen to me, O house of Jacob, and all the remnant of the house of Israel, who have been upheld by me from birth, who have been carried from the womb. Even to your old age, I am he, and even to gray hairs, I will carry you. I have made you, and I will bear you, even I will carry, and will deliver you. And then listen to these words of Jesus in the 5th chapter of Luke in the 31st and 32nd verses, and then a further word on that from Matthew 23:12. Those who are well do not need a physician, but those who are sick. I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. And whoever exalts himself will be abased, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. Let us pray. O blessed living Lord Jesus Christ, we feel the impact of your love reaching out for us. Forgive us in any way that we thwart that, and help us now to receive all that you have to give us and live the abundant life to the fullest. In your holy name, amen. One of my favorite stories is of a man who became very prideful about his golf. He had worked very hard to perfect his swing. He knew just how to select the right club, how to stand, and he did everything he could to be the best golfer. Now, he started to brag about it, of course, and took all the credit for himself, and one day he went out with some good friends and he said, there's one hole on this golf course, I'm going to make a hole in one, and I'm going to do it because I have practiced and perfected this game. And so they got to this hole, he got up on the tee, he put down his ball, he got his club in his hand, and he took the right kind of a swing. The ball was hit smartly and squarely, and it flew up in the air just perfectly, and then came down on the green and bounced, 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 within 6 inches of the hole, and it stopped. And then suddenly, out of the blue sky, came a gigantic eagle, and the eagle swooped down, landed on the green. From the tee, the man and his friends watched. The eagle walked over, put the ball in his beak, and then walked over to the hole, got in right over the hole, and went and dropped it right in the hole. And the man on the tee who had hit the ball threw down his club, looked up at heaven and said, Heavenly Father, I'd rather do it myself. The basic need of our life is that we say that all the time. We say it from the time we are small children, all through life, into maturity. We say it in our relationships, we say it in our problems, we say it in the challenges of life, we say it with the people we love, I'd rather do it myself. That's the essence of spiritual pride, of wanting to do for ourselves what only God can do, of wanting to carry God rather than allowing God to carry us. And this magnificent promise that I read from the 46th chapter of Isaiah, Isaiah the prophet observed the difference between being people who had to carry their gods and a people who were carried by their God. One New Year's Day, during the procession of the display of the gods of Babylonia, he observed something that helped him to understand how great Yahweh was and is. He watched the procession, great gigantic oxen carried the idols, Bel and Nebo, two of the prominent gods of the Babylonians. And he noticed that the idols were heavy and burdened down even the strong oxen. And then he saw them bow over as the oxen swayed back and forth. At times the people would almost go out to catch them in order to keep them stabilized. The gods of the Babylonians had to be carried. They had to be sustained. And then as Isaiah stood watching this, contemplating it, the Lord spoke in the depth of his heart. And he said, "Even to your old age, I am he. Even to your gray hairs, I will carry you." The difference between a religion that carries its gods and a God who carries us. Pride forces us to believe that we have to do for God what only he can do for us. Isn't it interesting then that long after Isaiah, when the people came back from the Babylonian exile, that under the influence of Ezra, a group of leaders were born and took a prominent place in the leadership of post-exilic Israel. They were called the scribes and the Pharisees. The very name Pharisee means separated ones. It comes from that Hebrew verb. They were the vigilantes. Their scribes interpreted the law in all of its annotations for the specific situations of life, and the Pharisees challenged the people to apply them to every aspect of life. They believed in the law of God. They anticipated a Messiah, but he would be like a military leader who would come back and release Israel from all of its oppressors. And they wanted an impeccable fulfillment of every letter of the law. When Jesus came, the heart of God yearning for his people, those who resisted him were the religious Pharisees. And the reason was, they had become so used to carrying their God that they could not experience the wonder of being carried by him. Feel it for just a moment. Think about it. Picture in your mind's eye someone you love very much and you'd like to help. You'd like to be able to give that person what he or she needs, the advice, the caution, the care. And yet, you feel from that person a resistance. All your overtures of love are held back as if not heard. And yet you yearn. You see the person hurting himself or others and pouring his or her life down the drain, and you yearn, you ache inside to do something about it. Do you know what that's like? How many of you do? Any of you got somebody in your life that you yearn over that way? Well, who doesn't? Now, multiply that yearning feeling, that longing to love. Multiply it 10 billion times, and you verily touched the heart of God. When he came in Jesus Christ, he yearned over his people. He wanted to care for them. Forgive them. He wanted to carry them. But the Pharisees, the religious people, the leaders, had come to a place that they'd gotten so used to carrying God, by their own rules and regulations, by their impeccable fulfillment of the details of their religion, that they could not receive the gift God offered. And that's what we see in vital, poignant, painful comparison. In this story of the calling of Levi, Levi displayed creative pride. The leaders of Israel, the Pharisees, displayed uncreative, destructive pride. Now, Levi had undoubtedly seen the Master, heard him, and I wonder if Jesus hadn't caught his eye as he stood at the edge of the crowd, listening, wondering, discerning. He had no right to listen to the Master. He was a tax collector, and people hated tax collectors, for those were the people hired by Rome to collect taxes. There was a certain base at which they could start, but there was no limit to how high they could go. And anything they collected over what Rome wanted was their own. And so they became abhorred, hated people, because they took from people more than the tax required. Well, Levi looked at the Master, and as he spoke, his heart leaped up inside of him. That contagious, winsome face of the Master caught him. He could not turn away. Oh, the grip of Jesus on the soul of men and women, especially on that tax collector. And when he looked at him, Levi knew that he was not excluded, put down, put off. He was loved. And then one day, as he was counting his acquired tax and all the extra that he'd gotten for himself, and as he was feeling the puffed up sense of his acquisitive nature, suddenly he looked up, and there he was, that Master, those eyes, that pulsating, relentless love. Two words were spoken: follow me. And everything within Levi responded. He wanted that more than anything else. Secondary to wanting to follow the Master was the desire to share with everyone what had happened to him. For between Levi's call and his recruitment to be a disciple, we are sure there were many conversations in which the Lord communicated his love to him. We know from other stories, such as Jesus' encounter with Zacchaeus, that Jesus didn't condone the practices of tax collecting at that time. And we're sure that what he did to Zacchaeus, he certainly did to Levi, and helped him to make restitution. And when it was all over, and Levi knew how much he was loved, he wanted everyone to know. Creative pride. He was proud of what had happened to him and proud of what Jesus had done in his life. And he had a banquet, called it at his home, invited all of his tax collector friends, and they celebrated what had happened to Levi. But there were some other people at that party. The scribes and the Pharisees were there, the religious people, and they had missed the very thing that had happened to Levi. They longed for the same thing, but they could not accept it because they were thwarting God and could not express their need for the Lord. And so they criticized Jesus for eating and drinking with tax collectors and sinners. And it was then that Jesus spoke these incisive words: only the people who are sick need a physician. He had not come to call the righteous, but sinners. And the one thing that the Pharisees could not admit was that they were sinners, that they needed Jesus Christ and his love. And so, in that magnificent 12th verse of the 23rd chapter of Matthew, Jesus drew it all into sharp focus. That those who exalt themselves will be abased, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. Wonderful truth. In a sense, when we put ourselves up and glorify ourselves, we must be put down. And when we lift up the Lord, He lifts us up. There are four words, four of the most important words that we can ever say. They are the secret to the abundant life, the secret to liberation, the secret to receiving power in our problems. And these four words are these: Lord, I need you. Now you see, what had happened in the Pharisees was that out of spiritual pride, they pretended that they needed the Lord and organized their lives to expose their piety. But deep down inside, there was a core of resistance. They were thwarting God. They had made the judgment of what God wanted in their own measly, puny rules and regulations, and had missed the greatness of the power of God in their lives. In reality, they couldn't say, "Oh God, I need you. I can't make it without you." And so they could stiff-arm Jesus and hold back his blessings and miss what he came to give them. Same thing happens in our lives. We pare down the Christian faith until we get it into a set of rules or regulations, or a few things that we do, a few prayers that we say, a few acts of benevolence that we do, a few kindnesses that we express, just so we can finally get to the place where we can say, like little Jack Horner in the corner, "Look, God, what a big boy am I." See, when inside we're still small and little, instead of the great people he created us to be, we keep on carrying him, seeking to be good enough for him. See, he created inside of each of us the longing to be right with him. That's as inherent in our human nature as gravity is in the natural world. A longing, a yearning to know him and to love him and to be right with him. And we take that and twist it around until finally we have something we can do on our own strength rather than trust him for his goodness. It is the problem of religious people. Wherever I go in America, people say to me, "Why is it that some churches are so dull? And why is it that so many Christians are so grim?" The secret is right here. It's because we have developed our faith to the level that we can do it on our own. And then pretty soon it becomes a burden. And we carry it with grim religious pertinacity, trying our best. And the world says, "If that's Christianity, I don't want any part of it." And yet, once we come to that magnificent moment in our lives when we recognize that we need him and cannot accomplish the purpose for which he has called us without his power, then we can relax, give him control of our lives, receive the power that he has to give us, and live the abundant life. Where are you saying no to him? Where are you blocking him? Where are you thwarting him? Where are you trying to carry your religion? Chesterton said, "Faith is a burden, but a wonderful burden. Like the burden sails are to a ship or wings are to a bird." Let the Lord lift you, pick you up and carry you. Underneath are the everlasting arms. Don't try and carry him in a dutiful, grim, turn down, put off kind of faith. The Lord wants to break our pride so that we can receive him and all that he has to give. And all we need to say are these four dynamic, powerful words: Lord, I need you.